Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this next session of ECHO Comprehensive Course in Echocardiography online program, the 44th in succession since 2000. We have with us our learned faculty and the program director and a chief scientific program director, as well as the president of these programs, Dr. Parashar, to talk on the basics of echocardiography in mitral stenosis. We have learned a lot till date about basics of echocardiography. What is my MO2D dimensions? What is my peak and mean gradients? And what is the velocity time integral and other things? With this few words, Dr. Parashar is being the mentor of Indian Academy of Echocardiography. He's the sole person behind Indian Academy of Echocardiography. He is a past president of Cardiological Society of India, Indian Academy of Echocardiography, and now the editor-in-chief of the second textbook of Indian Academy of Echocardiography. A very learned, devoted, and hardworking person, even at this age of 84, 85, hey, look at his talk, which is going to deliver today, a basics of echo in mitral stenosis. With this, sir, it's all yours.
So as the name indicates, it is a basic echo on mitral stenosis. We won't go into too much of details. As usual, we'll show a lot of images, but I think some of the images may have more importance when you do hands-on or you do yourself in these. Now, some basic revision slides, although Dr. Gupta has mentioned about it, but the basic revision slides are that, as you know, the mantra of stenotic lesions are 2D, CFM, and Doppler. As you know, why now? Because 2D gives you a semi-quantitative information. Color flow guides you to be parallel to Doppler, so this is always the sequence. Try to get the maximum velocities. Why and how? Always take multiple planes and take that plane which gives you the highest velocity, because that is used in hemodynamics. So never give diagnosis on one imaging plane or a single measurement. When you have any disease you see, always use a combination of multiple parameters before you give a diagnosis or so. Now, whenever you're doing an echo, for example, a stenotic lesion, see for any intercurrent illness. Suppose the patient comes to you for hypertension or patient comes to us with fever. We ask them to come back again when the fever is not there, or when BP is controlled, or any intercurrent illness should have been controlled, because they have got an effect on the assessing the severity of any disease. Then irregular rhythms and tachycardia are a problem which are going to do just now. Take an average of 3 to 5 measurements, as we have said repeatedly. See all the walls, whether it is a normal patient or not. Make a habit of seeing all the walls, that everything is fine. So these are some of the important parameters which you do. With the most important is use a multiple planes and multiple parameters. Slide one, most practically and frequently used centers, I've used it previously also. Any chamber subjected to prolonged pressure or the volume overload increases in size. Pressure overload like mitral stenosis, or volume overload like aortic regurgitation or mitral regurgitation, any chambers to this increases in size. So keep this in mind. This will help you in the whole course also. Second is hemodynamics. Always give an equal importance of 2D echo, which gives you a semi-quantitative idea of a severity, and then a correct Doppler to give you a more quantitative idea of severity. So these are important things. And as I told you before, always go for a clinical information. Don't just jump on the echo. Take a history, see the ECG, see the X-ray, do a quick clinical exam information, and then do a 2D echo and a Doppler. This is what I meant for using a multiple scanning planes. Use a scanning plane which gives you a maximum velocity, because ultimately this is used in hemodynamics. If the velocity is wrong, all your hemodynamics will be wrong, because your modified Bernoulli equation will also be wrong, which depends upon the velocity. And this is also has been discussed with you before, just a revision, that always when you planimeter any Doppler envelope, you get peak and mean gradients and the VTI, that is the velocity time integral, which has already been told to you. So this is a basic echo approach to a valvular heart disease. You start with a two-dimensional echo, which gives you a complete anatomical information and the functional information. But what is the functional? What is the function of the heart and complete anatomical? Then you go to the color flow mapping so that you can do a direct visualization of blood flow and guide the Doppler beam parallel to the flow. And then a Doppler echocardiography for a quantitative lesion. In some of the conditions, you do a peak gradient. In some of the conditions, like a mitral stenosis, we may not give importance to a peak gradient, but the calculation of valve area is equally important. So this is always the reason for a two-dimensional color flow and Doppler for a quantitative. And as I mentioned, this quantitative means a calculation of valve areas and some of the gradients. Now coming to mitral stenosis, a mitral stenosis is a narrowing of the mitral wall from the normal area more than four centimeters square. But suppose you get a patient whose area is about 3.2 centimeters square, don't jump to the diagnosis of a mitral stenosis. See other things, you might have calculated the mitral wall area wrong, but a value about like this or so, like 3 centimeters or 3.2, see all other features where they are present or not. But usual area is more than 4 centimeters square, and that is the one but is important in this case. Now etiology, for you, there are multiple causes of mitral stenosis, but for you, rheumatic is the most important etiology. And now with an increasing age of the patient, we are seeing some of the degenerative cases of a mitral stenosis. So these are, forget other things, these are other most important causes. And in a mitral stenosis, one of the basic things is that these are a short axis view, these are the commissures. So there is a fusion of the commissures at the annulus, which is one of the characteristic features of a mitral stenosis before also going to a thickening of the cusp, restricted movement, or a caudal thickening also, but the basic importance is a presence of a commissural fusion. You see more of a commissural fusion, and this gives rise to almost a fish mouth appearance. Then the rheumatic and degenerative, why I said that because of an increasing age, we are seeing a lot of patients of a mitral annular calcification. Now these are the mitral annulus, you can see they are heavily calcified. And in some of the cases, when this calcification extends to the base of the leaflets, it can produce a functional mitral stenosis. So these are quite commonly seen also. And so that whenever you get a case of a mitral annular calcification to which the leaflets are attached, always try to look for a gradient. For example, in the same patient, you can see there's a turbulence across the mitral wall. There is a mitral regurgitation, and you can see the increase the peak and mean gradients and the valve area. So these two, for you at this stage, are the most important causes of a mitral stenosis. So one is organic, one is the functional. Now, coming to it is very important to know the pathophysiology of every disease. I will simplify it in a very simple manner. In mitral stenosis, you know, as you we have told you, the mitral wall is between the left atrium and the left ventricle, and mitral wall opens in diastole, so that it allows the blood to flow from left atrium to left ventricular in diastole. Now, flow is maintained as long as LV pressure lower than LA pressure, because a flow is always from a higher pressure to a lower pressure chamber also. So the flow is maintained as long as the LV pressure lower. Now what happens in mitral stenosis, there is a mechanical obstruction of flow from LA to LV. So whenever there is an obstruction of the flow because of mitral stenosis, the LA pressure increases. So this LA pressure increase causes the flow to maintain from LA to LV. So the basic thing is that any chamber which is subjected to a prolonged pressure or a volume overload increases in size. So this prolonged pressure of the LA for a longer period to push the blood into the ventricle, the more narrow the wall, the greater will be the LA pressure. So this leads to a LA enlargement, atrial fibrillation, and LA clot over a period of time. The same increased LA pressure is transmitted back to the pulmonary veins because pulmonary veins are connected to LA. So when the LA pressure is increased, automatically the increased pressure is transmitted to the pulmonary veins, and this ultimately goes to the pulmonary artery, leads to a pulmonary artery hypertension. So that at this stage, a prolonged LA pressure can lead to a pulmonary artery hypertension because of the backflow. And at the same time, it leads to atrial fibrillation, which is usually found in a long-standing mitral stenosis when the LA is significantly large, and this predisposes to LA clot. Now, this pulmonary hypertension, as you know, the RV empties into the pulmonary artery. So when the pulmonary artery hypertension is there, so the increased load is on the RV. So this is known as the RV overload because the RV generates more pressure now to push the blood against an increased pressure. And this ultimately leads to right ventricular enlargement and a failure. So this is a basic pathophysiology, which I'm not going into a great detail of because of a stenosis of the mitral wall. Now, the diagnosis, so you know the etiology, you know the pathophysiology. The advantage of a pathophysiology is knowing is that you always see for LA enlargement, see for LA clot, see for RV thickening, and for a pulmonary artery hypertension. Now, remember, as I told you, that clinical examination is very important because you can diagnose a severity of this stenosis by a clinical examination, and echocardiography is the mainstay in evaluation. A good echocardiography does not need any cardiac catheterization unless you want to see the coronary arteries. So this clinical examination and echo are the main things. So now this is common to all valvular lesions, whether it is a mitral stenosis, aortic stenosis, tricuspid stenosis, because there is an inflammation of the walls or so, over a period of time, it can undergo thickening, fibrosis, or a calcification. And when a diseased valve is there, it causes a restricted opening because it is not a pliable valve. A pliable valve will open fully, while a diseased valve, it will open very partially. But the most important thing is a doming of the cusp in the direction of the flow. A doming is a specific sign of all stenotic lesions that is convexity towards the distal chamber. We'll show you just how, but we'll just take one word about the M-mode echo. You know, in an M-mode echo, this is the anterior leaflet, this is the posterior leaflet. The anterior leaflet is an M-shaped structure. So in a normal thing, this M-shaped structure is more anterior wall, and anti-mitral leaflet moves anteriorly, and this W-shaped posterior leaflet moves posteriorly. But when there is a mitral stenosis and there is a fusion of the cusps, they cause a paradoxical motion of the posterior cusp. Now, this is the most, if you are asked one specific sign, you see, here you see the anterior moves anterior, the posterior moves posterior. But in mitral stenosis, because of the fusion of the cusp, you see the posterior cusp also moves anteriorly. This is known as the paradoxical motion. So you see there is a restricted opening, there's deceleration slope is decreased, and there is a paradoxical motion. Again, you can see, because you can see the patient is in atrial fibrillation, this is anterior cusp, this is posterior cusp. the M pattern and the W pattern is lost and they move towards each other. So this number, this is the most important sign of M mode. So now coming to the, so you have seen a thickening, you have seen a restricted opening. Now the doming, now you see, this is the mitral parasternal long axis view. This is an anterior mitral leaflet. And you see like, this is like a reverse hockey stick or a finger like this. You can see the finger like this. It shows the doming of the anterior mitral leaflet with a convexity toward the left ventricle because the flow is from LA to LV. Now this is a sort of a still view. You see this is a parasternal long axis view and this is known as a doming. Hockey stick appearance also, and because you can see it is marked by an arrow. The posterior leaflet is also moving towards the anterior leaflet because of the fusion of the leaflet. So this is known as a doming with a convexity towards the left ventricle. Now, same thing you see, this is a aortic stenosis zoomed view. This is a zoomed view. This is the parasternal long axis view, interventricular septum, mitral wall. This is the aortic wall. And you can see a doming of the aortic cusp with a convexity toward the aorta because that is a distal chamber. You can see this doming of the cusp. Now this is again a still view. This is known as a doming of the cusp. So that is the convexity toward the distal chamber and this is a sign of any stenotic lesion. This is the aortic stenosis. Similarly, see the pulmonary stenosis. Now this is the pulmonary artery. This is the short axis view. And you can see the doming with a convexity toward the pulmonary artery. Again, you can see there is a doming of the cusp of this with a convexity toward the pulmonary artery. So the doming of the cusp, that is a convexity toward the distal chamber, is still a good sign. And you see this is a still movie, and you can see there is a doming and there is a convexity toward the pulmonary artery. And you see the tricuspid stenosis. Again, you see it is more, the doming is more toward the a distal chamber. And you see, so you have seen a stenosis of all the walls and all of them have shown a thickening. You can see a thickening of the cusp and all of them has shown a doming. So that is an important feature of most of the cases of any stenotic lesion. You can see this is a thickening, restricted movement, and you can see a doming toward the tricuspid RV. So that these are all the things. And as the valve narrows, gradients increase. As the valve is getting more narrow, the LA has to increase its pressure. Suppose you are pushing a man of 50 kg, you require a less pressure. If you are pushing a man of 90 kg, you require much more pressure to push that man. So when the valve narrows, the strain is always on the left atrium. So the left atrium increases its pressure. And that, as I told you, the gradient is difference of pressure between the two chambers. So there's increased gradient between LA and LV because as the valve narrows. Now, so that is the 2D summary of the mitral stenosis is 2D summary, a clinical examination, thickening of the cusp. You can see a marked thickening of the cusp. Here, the thickening always starts from the free edges and goes toward the body. Doming of the anterior mitral leaflet. Paradoxical motion of the posterior cusp going towards AML. Very restricted opening and chamber enlargement like a left atrium. So you can see the thickening, restricted movement and the paradoxical motion of posterior cusp. Remember that doming is a sign of mobility. We'll show you why. Now, sometimes any structure which obliterates the mitral wall can produce a functional mitral stenosis. For example, this is the left atrial myxoma. It's an apical four-chamber view. Because it goes in dash straight toward the mitral wall beyond, it can produce a functional mitral stenosis because of obstruction. There are many other causes also, like large vegetation and other things. But here, at this stage, we don't want to confuse you, but this is the mitral tricuspid wall, LV, and you see during gastric, it goes into the LV through the mitral wall, obstructing it, and then coming back into the LA. So now you have seen the etiology, you have seen the pathophysiology, you have seen what is the 2D and the M mode echo signs of mitral stenosis. So the next thing, as I told you, comes as to what is the severity of the mitral stenosis. Now, as I told you, a 2D echo gives you a semi-quantitative idea, but the most specific is the valve area, that is most specific. So let us come to the 2D at your level. For example, you see here, there is a sort of, this is mitral stenosis, there is a doming. You see the thickness of the leaflet, which just comes, usually starts from the tip and then gradually extends toward the body also. So here it is restricted here. The thickness is only mildly increased. The normal thickness is less than 4 to 5 millimeters and paradoxical. So we can say semi-quantitatively that possibly this may be a mild stenosis because of absence of significant calcification and a fairly good opening. Now compare it with this. So here you see there is a marked thickening of the whole of the anterior mitral leaflet. There is a further restriction of the opening, significant further obstruction of the opening, and there is a thickening of almost the whole of the anterior mitral leaflet, indicates a more moderate or could be a more severe or a moderately severe stenosis, indicating a fibrosis. Any fibrosis or calcification produces some echogenic structure. So you can compare it with this. The thickening is only restricted up to this area and there is a fairly good opening, but here you see it is very restricted opening and the whole thickening is going right up to the base of the leaflet. And here you see this is a calcified wall. You see there is hardly any mobility. And now this episode, as I told you that the doming is a sign of mobility of the cusp, but here you see there's hardly any doming and there's a huge, as if somebody has put a chalk on the mitral wall. So this whole calcification. So this automatically tells us that we will be dealing with a more severe mitral stenosis or a sort of a more advanced case of a mitral stenosis. So that this is how a semi-quantitative idea can be obtained by a 2D echo. However, as I told you, that wall area is the most important thing. And at your level, now there are various methods, but on a day-to-day practice, we calculate by what is known as a 2D planimetry or a pressure half-time. Now, if you are asked which is the gold standard, the 2D echo determination of the mitral wall area by planimetry is the most accurate method because it is not affected by any other hemodynamics or other valvular lesions. So we normally take a short axis view and the technique is from an aortic level, come toward the papillary muscle level. Start from the aorta, come toward the mitral wall and at the papillary muscle level. And when you see the papillary muscle level, reverse back toward the aorta, and as soon as you see the mitral wall, you freeze it and you optimize this mitral wall area. And if the commissures are open, you also and always zoom it and optimize gain setting. If the gain is very high, it will encroach on the orifice and reduce artifactually this. Actually, this is the thing which you should practice daily. Because this is the thing, everybody gets confused also. Once you start with the principle, that start with the aorta, go toward the papillary muscle, then from there, as soon as you see the papillary muscle, go back, start going back toward the aorta, and as soon as you see the mitral orifice that is usually seen at the tip of the leaflets. For example, here you see the measurement is about 0.8 centimeters square. Here, that is how we measure in a short axis view. And when the commissures are open, you include the commissures into the mitral wall area, which is about 1.5 centimeters square. So you take from the inner edge, and just go towards here, include the open commissure, and that will give you the mitral wall area. Now, here we are talking more theoretical But once you, those who are doing an echo, always try to calculate a multiple wall area, or even in a normal patient, so that you can know how to calculate it. Now, again, you see, again, you go see, we are going back, and then this will be the mitral wall area. Now, it is always important to define these are the commissures. Here you see the commissures are fused. Here almost they are fused. Here the lateral commissure is open. Here the lateral and the medial commissures are opening. Now, this is going to impact on the further intervention by a balloon dilatation also, because the person like this will not be benefited by balloon, because they only split the commissures also. For example, here you see the lateral commissure is split, and if we have to measure the area, we will measure from here, take the commissures and go back to here. So always try in a moving picture to see the commissure. And here you see, this is the medial commissure. It is split. So try to practice it, the commissures also, because in a short Texas view, you see three things. Number one, the pattern of commissures. The number two, the mitral wall area. And third is LA appendage that we'll come to subsequently later on. So this is a very important view, a short Texas view, and you should repeatedly sort of practice in seeing the commissures and also calculating the mitral wall area. Never go on one single measurement. Even in any case also, in a mitral wall area, take a minimum three measurements. All of them may be slightly different, and take an average of three. Never take only single measurement for a mitral wall area. Just take about three, four times or so, and then take an average. It is more in atrial fibrillation. Now see, the limitations are that it's about 5 to 7% of cases, the imaging is very suboptimal. Why? Either the patient is obese, either the patient is COPD, and you are not able to see the mitral wall area despite your best efforts. Do not try to comment it unless you can see a good mitral wall orifice. Otherwise, you'll be sort of upsetting the opinion of the referral doctor. In atrial fibrillation, now the problem comes in atrial fibrillation is it is very irregular contractility. Sometimes the area looks small, sometimes the area looks large. So you don't know. In there, do several measurements and then take an average. Sometimes when there's a very highly fibrous and calcified wall, it may impinge over the area and you can get this. And this is more important, is the lack of technical expertise. So because many of you just take a short Texas view, but don't spend time on the mitral wall till you get it, and the instrument settings also, your gain should be neither too high, neither too low. So these are the four things which apply to you. And in our day-to-day practice, if I tell you, it is number one, it is number two, and this is number three. Then other things come subsequently. Now, the other way is known as a pressure half-time. Now, don't spend too much time on physics. You'll get confused like all of us. Now, a pressure half-time is the time required for the pressure gradient across the wall to fall from its peak value to half of this. You will get confused with this, but only remember this which the machine gives automatically, that is 220 divided by the pressure half time gives the mitral wall area. Suppose this is the mitral wall area, this is a deceleration slope, and you just trace a deceleration slope. And if you have got a good deceleration slope, automatically you will get a mitral wall area. Now here you see more severe the stenosis, the time required for the pressure gradient to fall is much delayed. So this is delayed. I'm not going into too much complex of this, only telling you how to calculate it, that this is a method to calculate a mitral wall area. Now, for example, you see, this is the mitral wall Doppler. This is E, this is F. So you can call it either a deceleration slope, or you can cause a mitral deceleration. You see, the pressure half time is 121 or so. So 220 divided by 121, automatically the machine gives a area of 1.8 centimeter square. So you have to, only your duty is to get a good Doppler, and the slope should be very well seen. If you are not very well seen, then it doesn't serve the purpose. Again, you see, another patient in atrial fibrillation, I'll tell you the limitations. Again, you measure the EF slope, and here the pressure half time is 182 milliseconds. So 220 divided by 182 is 1.2 centimeters. So you have to get a good deceleration slope. You have to measure, you have to just clearly meter the slope, and automatically the equipment gives you a mitral wall area. Now, there are certain limitations. Only I will tell you the common limitation which you will feel in your day-to-day practice. When a person is coming to you, now what we have seen, once the heart rate is more than 90 or so, it produces a sort of a not a good imaging. So, and there is no time to reassure the patient also. So what we do, for example, let us see. Now this is sinus tachycardia. Now you cannot say which your EF slope, which your deceleration slope. So normally what we do in these cases is, we ask them to take a dose of a beta blocker in the night, maybe 12.5 or 25 milligram of short acting beta lock, and then take another dose about 2 hours before they come to the echo lab. So let them take two doses of this beta blocker, and because the heart rate will settle down, so after this thing, what you can do, you can get a sort of, I'm just giving an example, your slopes get separated. The more the tachycardia, the slopes get fused, and you have no time to go on reassuring the patient, give him tranquilizer. So give him one dose in the night and 2 hours before the patient comes the next day, and see, and let the patient wait and see if the tachycardia settle down, and then you take a pressure half time. And the very important thing is atrial fibrillation. These are things you will see very common in patients of mitral stenosis by the time they come to you. So here what we do, you go on recording multiples. You go on recording till you get a slope which has got a 5 diastolic slope. There is bound to get a envelope with a wide diastolic interval, and you can take an average if you want. Or for example, here you see. Now you cannot measure anything. This is all atrial irregular complexes, irregular contractility. But you keep your one finger on the stop button, pause button, and as soon as you get a mitral Doppler with a wide diastolic slope, you can measure this as the deceleration time. For example, here you cannot measure anything there. This is the same patient, another patient. You see multiple complexes of atrial fibrillation, but one wide diastolic slope, have a patient also, and then you can get an area which is about 0.5 centimeter square, because 220 divided by 428, they come to about 0.5 or so. So this is a common problem which you'll feel. And the third problem which you'll feel in a very, very common thing is a non-linear slope. These are common, we have seen, because here the patient is, because of disease and because of stress, the patient has tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, if he comes in a later stage, non-linear slope. Now, this is a diagrammatic representation. What is a direct non-linear, you see, initially there is a very rapid down slope, and then there is a gradual slope also. So now here what you do, if by mistake you measure from here to here, the pressure half time comes about 100 milliseconds. That way the area will be much more. So here what we do, you measure from the mid-diastolic person, and the same pressure half time comes about 180 milliseconds. So here you will overestimate the area. So this is an initial, this is known as a bimodal diastolic flow. You do not take this method, but take from the mid portion and go back as we have shown here. This is the correct method. For example, you see here, this is an incorrect method. because it has been shown measured here, but here it is the correct method. It has been shown to be measured, for example, we'll show you here. Now this is incorrect because you are measuring this slope, but the correct method is measured from a mid-diastole or from this. Now this is the correct method. So remember this, you'll get very frequently in your day-to-day practice. Now again, you see, here you see, this is just to show, if you measure the initial slope, the area comes about 2.4 centimeters square. But when you, and you see 2.4 centimeters square, because you are measuring the initial slope. But the same, if you measure it from the mid-diastolic slope, the same area comes to 1.4 centimeters square. So never measure from here to here, but take a middle portion and go back, and from there measure. You'll find it very frequently in your practice. And then there are these are some of the, I'm not talking about going to a very complicated of your regurgitation or so. So, and then after you have taken a pressure half time, and remember two things, a pressure half time method, whenever there is a balloon dilatation, it is invalid for about first 48 to 72 hours. So sometimes the intervention cardiologists, without knowing it, they have done a balloon valvotomy, and then they send the same day or in the next morning to calculate a mitral wall area. In those patients, the pressure half time is still not valid, and you do a 2D wall, 2D area, you can see. So don't do this for the first 48 to 72 hours. Then you can go for the mean gradients. You see, this is an apical view. Why we take an apical view for the mitral wall always? Because you are parallel to the flow. You see a turbulence. Now you see here, if you put a blindly, it would have gone like this. But here you see the jet is eccentric. So we have to put the jet like this, not straight. And here you get this. You trace it and you get the various peak and mean gradients and the VTI. Now remember why we are giving less importance to this mean gradients nowadays, because it is very much subject to heart rate and cardiac output. The more the heart rate, and depending on cardiac output, this varies also, because there are various reasons for it. So this, at your level, what are the steps for Doppler study of mitral wall? Step one, obtain maximum velocity. How? By taking an apical view. So this is how to take a maximum velocity. Obtain mean gradient and TVI. How? By planar metering the Doppler one. Measure MVA by PST method, because this is also a Doppler parameter. This is also after you have got a good. So you must have a good deceleration slope. Then continue the patient, you can forget for the time being. Then in the same way, determine the PA pressure. How? By getting a TR jet velocity. So just by an apical view and getting a good Doppler view, you can get these four things very, very easily. For example, this is again the revision of a TR jet, and this is how you calculate a mean PA pressure is 0.6 into 130 plus 2, about 70-80 millimeters must be the mean value or so. So this is how you calculate a PA pressure, which has already been told to you possibly in the last lecture. So now what is the, how do you grade the severity? Now things have changed after 2014. In pre-2014, we used to call this a severe mitral stenosis when it was less than one, like here. We used to call moderate 1 to 1.5, and this was about mild. But after 2014, according to ACCHA criteria, they have said severe, when it is less than 1.5 centimeter square, they call it severe. And when to get a 1.5 centimeter square, the PhD will be more than 150, 220 divided by 150 will be 1.5. Then what we used to call it is severe, below one, they now call it very severe also. So the problem comes now, when we write a report now, because many persons may not be aware of this criteria. So if suppose your patient comes at 1.3 centimeter square, in the earlier one, it should have come as a moderate. So when we write severe, in a bracket, we write ACC EHA criteria 2014. Otherwise, tomorrow they will say, since when 1.3 centimeter, 1.4 centimeters have become a severe. So more than 1.5 is simply a mild to moderate, and below 1.5 is severe, and below one is very severe mitral valve body criteria. So this is the new criteria, and you see in many of the cases, they don't give importance to peak mean gradient, but as you know, as the valve area goes on decreasing, the mean area goes on increasing, and the same is pulmonary artery systolic pressure. So even if you click on your computer, post 2014 ACC EHA criteria for valvular lesion, you can get all these values. So this is the current method we use, and not the P214. Now, so by now you know what is mitral stenosis, you know what is the pathophysiology, you know how to diagnose it, both by M mode and 2D. You know how to calculate the severity of mitral stenosis by various methods also. But you have to see something more in a complication. We'll only show you simple ones. This is known as a spontaneous contrast echo. You see there is a marked doming of the anterior mitral leaflet. The patient is in flutter fibrillation. So this spontaneous contrast echo, also known as a smoke in the left atrium smoke, is because of the very low flow state and the roule formation of the RBCs and WBC, and they are flowing very, very slow. So because of the low flow state, you see this contrast effect, which is known as a smoke So this is known as a spontaneous contrast echo. Any low flow state, for example, you see this is an ischemic heart disease with a very poor LV function, you can see the smoke. Again, this is because of a very low flow state, very poor output, and the RBCs and WBCs, they form a formation, and you can see. So that it is a thing which is seen in all cases, wherever there is a very low flow state, as you can see that a smoke into the left ventricle. So whenever you see a spontaneous contrast echo, you always see for any clots. This move, the next one, I think, because what I wanted to show that you can see the multiple clots here in the left atrium. You can see, with varying clots also. So whenever you see a spontaneous contrast echo, you always try to see for a thrombus present in these situations also. Again, I don't know why they have stopped moving. So this, when you are seeing in a short axis view, they were moving till. Just a minute. Hope I won't disturb this thing. Are the slides visible or not yet? Oh, see, it is moving now. So you can see multiple clots. Are the slides visible?
It's visible, sir. Visible.
Achha. So this is how what is known as the left atrial appendage. This you will get by practice, not by theoretical. By telling you, this is a short axis view. This is the aorta. This is the left atrium, and this is a finger-like projection into the left atrium, which is known as the left atrial appendage. Now, normally what we do when we get a pulmonary artery in a short axis view, we slightly rotate the probe that the pulmonary artery disappears, and then you see the appendage. And sometimes you can already transesophageal is the best method, but sometimes you can see an appendage, a clot in the appendage. You see here, it is absolutely clear. Here you see this patient, there is a clot in the left atrial appendage. You can see this arrow. So that, and here you see, don't see the whole of the pulmonary artery. You have just manipulated the transducer so that you only see the left atrial appendage. Now this is just to show that this is the pulmonary artery. Now here you are not seeing the appendage very well, but when you slightly rotate the transducer, and the pulmonary artery tends to disappear, then you can get you can see now, a moving picture. If we are not seeing the pulmonary artery, this is a spontaneous contrast echo in the left atrium, and you can see a large thrombus into the left atrial appendage. So try to focus and try to see the transesophageal, and try to see a transthoracic left atrial appendage in all cases. So that if you start practicing now, you'll really not miss it when you want to do it. Now, again, you see, this is a clot into the left atrial appendage moving from the LA or so. So that, as I will repeat again, whenever you do a routine echo, always try to see for mitral wall area. Always try to see for tamishas. Always try to focus on left atrial appendage. If you start practicing now, possibly after 30, 40 cases, you will start getting these things. And that will help you when you really get a case of mitral stenosis. Of course, this is just to show how this point, this is a transesophageal view. You can see a sort of a mobile thrombus, also large and spontaneous contrast echo. So many, sometimes about 7% of patients in sinus rhythm can also get a thrombus. Now this is this because you will not see so frequently. A lutein Barker syndrome has been described as a mitral stenosis and an ASD. So this I brought it. This is maybe difficult for you, but you see, this is the LA, this is the RA. And this is the flow from the LA to RA, indicating of atrial septal defect. And you see all the signs of mitral stenosis. So a combination of mitral stenosis and atrial septal defect, either congenital or acquired from a balloon valvotomy, is known as a Lutyen-Barker syndrome. So just out of curiosity. Now, lastly, we come to stress echo. When there is a mismatch between clinical symptoms and resting hemodynamics, then you try to do a stress echo, which we do quite frequently in our cases, or because the question is, are the symptoms due to severe stenosis? Are they because of COPD? Are they because of obesity? Or they are poor conditioning exercise? So what we do, we calculate a resting mean gradient and PA pressure before the exercise, then give exercise till symptoms occur, or at least about 70% of the heart rate is obtained, and repeat the mean gradient and these again. Now in the recent months or so, few more indications have come that the patient is has got significant MS, and but there are no symptoms. Why? Or the patient has got a non-significant MS and the symptoms are there. Is it because of mitostenosis or not? And sometimes when there is a mitostenosis, no symptoms prior to a non-cardiac surgery, or if the patient wants to undergo pregnancy. So you have to see that what is the status of the mitostenosis and the pregnancy. And these are the modes of exercise. We normally prefer a treadmill test because we are more familiar with it and it is more available. This is usually not available. And some of you who do not have an echo machine and treadmill machine in the same room, you can do a just leg raising exercise. Just raise the patient's leg at about 60 degrees for about a minute or so. And when the heart rate increases, again repeat it. Or what we used to do decades back was to do a sit-ups also. Patient is sitting, lying. So that the aim is to increase the heart rate, to increase the gradients. So how do we interpret it? When the gradient becomes more than 15 millimeters on exercise or more than 18 millimeters during double tween, or a pulmonary artery systole becomes more than 60 mm after exercise, because this has got a prognostic value. So sometimes you can see, for example, here you see, this was a 53-year-old lady with a MS and deep dyspnea. Now, what are the reasons for the symptom? It is because of obesity, lack of exercise, COPD. You see, pre-dobutamine, here we have just to demonstrate, we have not taken you see, all the three are different. So ideally, what we should do is take an average of all three. You see, it is coming up to this. It is coming up to this, but this is going up to this. So, and then here it comes to about 5.9 or so, 5 millimeters as a mean gradient. Now you exercise this patient and it goes up to 20 millimeters of mercury. So that means there is a significant increase in the gradient, which tells us that her symptoms are more because of a mitostenosis rather than obesity also. And pulmonary artery pressure also goes from 36 to 60 millimeters of mercury. So this confirms. So we still do a lot of stress echoes in our lab also when we have a doubt about the symptoms or a doubt about the gradients also. So this is a final approach to a mitostenosis. You start with a parasternal long axis view. You see a parasternal long axis view for two, three things. See for the mitral wall opening, see for domain, how much is it opening, see for a spontaneous contrast echo, and you see for any presence of a thrombus. You have to search well for this thing, for a thrombus or so. So you start with a parasternal long axis view and see these three, four things very clearly. And one thing we always see is, this is known as the mitral wall separation index. If you take a parasternal short long axis view and an apical view and see the distance between the two. Now, as expected, the more severe the wall stenosis, the lesser will be the opening. So if it is less than 8 millimeters or so, it indicates a severe stenosis. 8 to 12 is moderate and beyond is mild. This we have taken more of for a clinical interest and M mode to see how a spontaneous contrast echo looks in the left atrium. And so that in a parasternal long axis view, you see for a spontaneous contrast echo and a thrombus, you see the whole anatomy of the mitral wall and see the separation index of this. Then in a short axis view, as I told you, what you see is, number one, you see again an LA enlargement and again a thrombus. You see for a left atrial appendage for any thrombus and a mitral wall area. Now here you see this is a commissure also, and you see there is a calcification of the commissures. So that means this patient is unfit for a mitral valvotomy because they split the commissures, and if they want to split this commissure, this will lead to a rupture of the valve also. So three things to see in a short excess view. Number one, a mitral wall area. Number two, a commissures, how they are. And number three, a thrombus into the left atrial appendage. And of course, whenever you see a spontaneous contrast echo, you see for a thrombus. And in an apical view, a short excess view, as I told you, you see for a orifice area, and both by a pressure half time and by a 2D. Remember, this is the important one. And then in an apical and subcostal views, besides studying the gradients of valvular apparatus, you see for a TR and the presence of a velocity or so. What is the TR velocity for the presence of a pulmonary hypertension, and see for IVC, its size and for its collapse also, to calculate the pulmonary artery pressure by seeing the RA curve. Now this was known as the Wilkinson score, in which we used to give them, depending upon the mobility, about 4 points, thickening 4, cauld involvement and calcification. Long time back, we used to say that 8 points are sufficient for a balloon valvotomy. Beyond that, no. But now they are doing it between 8 to 11. It has got a short term and long term prognosis. So there are various, but surprisingly, they have not included commissures in it. So you just, if the mobility, you score from 1 to 4 and all these, and you then ultimately the whole sum of the scores you see, and that give you a final score by Wilkinson also. So whenever you give a report, you always give it I'll tell you, come to again, a type of wall thickening, how it is there, type of commissures, degree of MR, a subvalvular apparatus, LA or appendage clot, pulmonary artery pressure, concomitant severe other valvular disease. I re-stress here that always go to a short excess view and practice all the three things and everything for three things I told you. And when you give a final report, always mention heart rate, BP, and rhythm. Because what I say, if today you have done a heart rate of 70, tomorrow somebody gives that a heart rate of 90, then some of the Doppler findings may be variable. So you can write that this study was done at a heart rate of this and this, BP of this and this, and the patient was in sinus rhythm or in atrial fibrillation. So that you cover yourself by this. And those patients who are in atrial fibrillation, we always write in the end that some of the hemodynamic findings could be variable because of a irregular rhythm. Then you give an anatomical appearance of the wall. Thickening, fibrosis, calcification, how much extent of thickening. Then you have to give severity of stenosis as well by various methods, what we have told you, any anatomical complications, what we have told you. Presence and severity of MR is present, degree of pulmonary hypertension, any other valve involvement, giving an idea of LV and RV function, and commissures and subvalvular apparatus to make it amenable to balloon valvuloplasty, and always mention some of the limitations of this study. Don't feel shy. Sometimes we write that the mitral wall area may be variable by 2D method because of the atrial fibrillation, or we say because of suboptimal imaging. So that your report should be such that you should give a complete report that just what is the severity and whether the patient undergoes a balloon dilatation, whether the patient will undergo a death. So always give a complete report. A few words about tricuspid stenosis, not much. Now, previously, many times, we might have missed the tricuspid stenosis, not caring, just caring about the mitral wall, and not looking at this mitral cusp stenosis. But now it is a practice to always see all the walls, especially tricuspid wall. Pulmonary valve is very, very rarely involved in rheumatic process. So, but aortic and the tricuspid must be carefully seen or so. A normal velocity is 0.5 to 1.0 meter per second. Annulus, the mean diastolic diameter is 3.1, but a dilated annulus is 2.1 centimeter by meter square, or if you want to take a rough value, 3.5 to 4 centimeters. Because if you are no facility of taking a body surface area, if you have to write whether what is the tricuspid annulus to take in diastole, then the valve is fully open, and from base to base at the annulus, measure the distance. The mean gradient is usually less than 2 millimeters. As we told you on the first lecture, that in a right-sided valve, always measure in end expiration. Because the valve, the velocity will always measure will be different between inspiration and expiration. So always measure in end expiration. So it is more stable also, because during inspiration, the flow increases. And when do we call it as a severe tricuspid stenosis? When the mean gradient is increased, pressure heart time is more than 190 milliseconds per second, or valve area is less than 1 centimeter, greater the stenosis, greater will be the RA enlargement, greater will be the IEC. So for example, here you see, this is the left ventricle, right ventricle, the patient has got a very thickened this. Now, by seeing that mitral wall, we possibly feel that he will require a mitral wall replacement. But at the same time, you see the tricuspid wall is showing a restricted opening and is thickened. So the tricuspid wall also shared a restricted, normally it would have opened right up to this place. But here you see a restricted opening and thickening. RA enlarged. And when you put a color flow mapping, you see besides TR, there is a turbulence across the tricuspid wall. So whenever there is a suspicion even of a turbulence or an aliasing, then you have to put it a continuous wave Doppler here. And what we find, you see here, this is TR, the gradients are 18 and 7.5 significantly increased. The same thing, take an average of 3, trace it, you get peak and mean gradient. And here you see the pressure half time is about 0.9 centimeter. That means 220 divided by 243 automatically is up to 0.9 centimeters, so that the patient has got a significant tricuspid stenosis. So only this much I can say. And in a summary, I can say that always never go by one parameter. Take all the scan planes, see all the views. You will get a lot of information from a short X-ray view, and then you can give your final diagnosis. Now, any questions from you? Because I've not gone into very details, because that is not meant for you at this stage. You will get confused also. Now, any questions from your side? You can unmute yourself.
Sir, my question is, sir, good afternoon.
Hello.
Sir, my question is whether to take a pressure half time in continuous wave Doppler or pulse wave Doppler?
It is, you have to get a good slope. And as we have told you, whenever you are expecting a high velocity flow, you go by a continuous wave Doppler. So okay. Your aim is to get a good Doppler study and a good deceleration slope. And because in mitral stenosis, there are usually high velocity flows. So to avoid aliasing, it is always you take any disease flow, always try to take a CW Doppler. Now I have shown you one or two slides, you have a pulse Doppler. If the stenosis is very mild, then because you get a better slope with a pulse Doppler at times. But the majority of the time you have to take whether you take a pulse or a CW, there should be no aliasing and the slope should be very fine and so that to measure it also. But normally, you know, we have been taking a CW Doppler in a disease of all also.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, how does the deceleration time and pulse pressure half time are different while taking and graphs? Can you differentiate both
pressure half time? They are the same thing. You see, this is known as a deceleration time is something different, which will be told to you when you are taught a diastolic slope also. There you take a time, but here you are taking a millimeter per second or so. You see,
sir, I'm just asking about the method of the taking and the graph. Both are different or same?
Number two, in a diastolic thing, you always take a pulse Doppler. Okay. All the diastolic functions are done on a pulse Doppler, and there is a deceleration time. You measure time there, it will always, you see, it is always giving us a slope and the time also. And there you can see a mitral Doppler, because you are seeing only by a pulse Doppler also. So this is known thing. It is the same thing in mitral stenosis, we can call it a deceleration slope. In a Doppler, we can call it a deceleration time. You measure again from the method is the same. But you can get a time different. And here you see the button you press, that is a different also. So there you take a mitral Doppler by a pulse one. Here you get a CW Doppler. And when you take a time, you get a deceleration time also by the same method also. You take an E wave, A wave, E slope, all that. That will be told to you when you are taught about the diastolic interval. That is only a pulse Doppler also. That will be told to you, I think.
Okay.
So is there anything called submalleolar stenosis when you are taking mitral valve test around mild to moderate, but when you measure the pressure gradient, sometime mean pressure gradient?
Yes, I did not purposely bring this slide of a subvalvular apparatus. Now, what happens in subvalvular apparatus? The mitral slope, because you are measuring a 2D slope, the 2D is a 2D area will be less. And when you take a Doppler, then you are seeing both the valve and the subvalvular apparatus, and you will see the gradient will be much more marked in those cases as compared to this other one also. So the thing is that the 2D area may be 1.2, 1.3, but from a pressure half time, it may be 0.8. And the gradient will be much more as compared to the valve area. And on a color flow mapping, you will see that the turbulence starts at beyond the valvular level as compared to the valvular level. I've got it in other slide and lecture. I've got that. So we'll try to show you sometime when I meet next time. So the turbulence will start, the flow acceleration will start beyond the valvular level, because it is at the subvalvular apparatus. Then the 2D area will be more, because you are measuring at the valvular level, but the gradient will be high. And so that a comparison of valve area, gradient, and the color flow mapping will give you an idea of whether you are dealing with a subvalvular lesion or not.
Yeah, so those kind of patients, there's a balloon valvotomy, not much improvement.
They will not be helped by valvotomy, because in valvotomy, you are only trying to split the commissures also. That is the problem.
Sir, what is the role to calculate VTI in mitral valve?
How do you calculate VTI in the aortic valve?
Sir, this is to just clarify the fluid responsiveness. Actually, we calculate VTI in aortic valve. But what is the
same thing? whichever wall you planimeter, you get a VTI. And that was the first revision slide I show you. See, this is a mitral Doppler. You have traced it and you get a VTI.
And what is the significance of this, sir?
VTI?
In mitral wall?
No. There is definitely a significance. Once you do it a quantitative equation method to calculate the mitral wall, it comes into that, because the flow across mitral wall is equal to flow across LVOT, and flow is equal to your VTI into your area or the diameter. So there the VTI comes in picture also. But so whether it is anywhere, the VTI, you always get this by planimetry, automatically get a VTI. In LVOT, it has got a different significance. In mitral wall, when you see for a... So there you get it by the for the mitral wall area. So that is where the what that is the significance it comes in this. That is the significance of this in this. Because our lecture is supposed to be basic, hence I told you that we'll, but anything which you want, again, I told you that you can let us know the details.
Sir, is it important to take EF slope for mitral stenosis?
No. Say the EF slope, the it is only for documentation.
Okay. It doesn't correlate with severity.
Say you see this is the sort of EF slope.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
The EF slope can be reduced in conditions other than mitral stenosis.
Okay.
Now they will also tell you when you do a diastology that this EF slope can be reduced. So the EF, the fourth thing which we are told in the M-mode echo was a thickening of the cusps, a restricted opening, decrease in EF slope, and paradoxical motion of the posterior cusp. So the most important one is the paradoxical motion of the posterior cusp. Because you can always mention an EF slope, that the EF slope is this and this. It is only supportive finding, not a diagnostic finding. Because for example, the opening of the restriction, the opening of a wall depends upon the amount of blood flowing into it. The cases of a dilated cardiomyopathy with a poor LV function, you'll find that the opening of the mitral wall is restricted because less flow goes through it. So the restricted opening can be found in many situations, including an AR jet impinging on the mitral wall. And this is also found in old age also, you can get EF slope reduced in it because of a diastolic dysfunction. But most important is this paradoxical motion. Loss of M and W pattern.
So less than 15.
Loss of M and W pattern. Pardon?
Severity of the mitral lesion cannot be decided by that.
No. Severity, as I told you, the severity is always a decided by other factors also.
Yeah.
Now see, as I told you that wall area by 2D planimetry is the gold standard also. Now here also the 2D echo gives you just idea, semi-com, because you always start with the 2D echo. Because the basic principle is to get the whole anatomy of the wall, which you can get only by 2D echo. But the severity can be dependent on these factors. So that's a 2D planimeter. So you can, so by an EF slope, you cannot determine the severity of the wall. That is not done. For years, so then you will diagnose every case of mitral stenosis in elderly individuals.
Sir, my question is, when we trace the graph of pulse, we can trace the graph for taking mean and pressure gradient, but we have to trace for continuous wave Doppler or the graph of pulse wave Doppler, which wave Doppler we have to trace?
Now, in microstenosis, will you use a pulse Doppler or a CW?
We will use a continuous wave Doppler for MS. And
so because the first day we told you that any high velocity flow, any disease flow at a rough language, at lower level, we always use a CW Doppler.
Okay, thank you.
That will give you sort of a better. Sometimes we have compared the take. In both M mode and the CW we have found has been giving a slightly higher velocities also. So it is, remember, basic thing that when to use pulse Doppler, when to use CW Doppler, that was the very first day also.
So what's the correct method of measuring LSI in parastinal long axis or both chamber view, sir?
Say at your level, and because now we are giving less importance to LA size also as compared to volume, but the traditional method has been to just a measure from this a parastinal long axis view. You take a M mode here and put, and if you take a CW, now the question is that the many of the measurements are done by 2D, but if you're doing by an M mode, as you said, you put your M mode cursor here and you take the measure the length here. Because the LA can enlarge in any direction, this is a multi-dimensional structure, but I think for the measurement, this is still the parastinal long axis is a good method also. Volume we can measure from the apical force chamber view. An LA volume will be told to you when a Doppler will be studied also.
So when we do echo and we found that.
Now we did not tell you this thing because this would have been too much for you, that how does a cold dry atrium looks like also. This is the left atrium, this is the mitral wall, this is the membrane into the left atrium, cold dry atrium, which can be misdiagnosed as a mitral stenosis. So today we have gone on basics on mainly.
Sir, if we found the thickened wall, then how can we differentiate whether it is rheumatic or it is degenerative?
Say the thing is depending upon the age also. In a rheumatic wall, the left leaflets are more thickened at the tip because the disease starts at the tip. And in a mitral annular calcification, it is the posterior mitral annulus which is involved. And this involves the base of the leaflets. That is why in many cases of a degenerative, you may not see the presence of a doming also. So the thickness is usually more seen in a case of a rheumatic process when it is about more than 5 to 6 millimeters or so. Because that in rheumatic process, the disease starts from the tip of the leaflet and then goes beyond that. In a degenerative one, it starts from the mitral annulus and then goes toward the base of the leaflets. So that is more in cases of a rheumatic.
So one of my senior told that you will find more whiteness towards the tip in rheumatic.
Pardon me?
The tip mein jala safed milega, sir, aise bola wo. More white. You will find more whitening towards the tip in rheumatic wall.
That is what I'm telling you.
The thickened and white.
You can find more at the tips also.
Yes, sir.
That is what I just told you. Now you see, you take this. Now you see the more thickening is toward the tip of here as compared to this thing. It is more toward the leaflet tips or so.
Yes,
and the same thing is shown here, that the thickening is much more here as compared to the other places also. And if you take now you see, you compare this. Now here you see that the thickening is more toward this apical side also. And in the fibrosis, you can see it will be more coming towards the base now. So it goes from the apex to the base also. That is the thickening in that case. Whatever your senior told you may be correct.
So is there any clinical significance of Wilkinson's score selected in the mitral valve balloon size?
Yes, I thought you why previously it was the Wilkinson score was a prognostic value in immediate and long-term outcome after the mitral valvotomy. So previously they used to say the lesser the score, the better it is. So the 8 was the cutoff point. That up to 8 o'clock, it is very safe to do a balloon valvotomy. Then later on, it went up to 8 to 11. That 8 to 11 is a fairly still it is a satisfactory, but beyond 11, that means it is a significant sort of a thing. So they said it is not adverse. It only gives an indication of your immediate and long term prognosis after the balloon valvotomy. And there are many other scores. There it is not Wilkinson was the first one to come. There are many other scores. Corneal score and whatnot, different slopes or so.
So I'm especially asking whether Wilkinson score is determine the balloon size compared to height and all.
Balloon size they only determine when you give them an area. So they've got a different criteria. Balloon size is usually checked in cases of an atrial septal defect also. Here you tell them that this is the, for example, balloon size, they may depend on the aortic stenosis. Here we tell them that this is the area. And then they have their own method of doing it also.
Sir, one more question by one of the students is, sir, how to know the correct site for measuring mitral valve area by planimetry? How can we know about it?
As you see, when I told you that you must practice every time, for example, I'll tell you, say normally you take a short axis view. Okay, you start from the aorta. From the aorta, you come towards the papillary muscle. As soon as you see the papillary muscle, you reverse the direction of the transducer till you see the first beat of the mitral wall, mitral orifice. Because that is the advantage of a 3D echo, because it cuts right at the tip of the leaflets. That comes a leaflet also. So take a short axis view, and as I told you, from the aorta to the subpapillary muscle, from the papillary muscle, reverse the direction toward the aorta, and as soon as you see the mitral wall, then it is set to zoom the image and take a mid-diastole also. So these are the, and you gain settings. If your gain settings are very high, then all these extra gains will come into the mitral wall area and will be reduced the size. If your gain settings are very low, then you will overestimate the mitral wall area. So that is the advantage of a MVA planimetry also. So this is how, as I said, that it will only come by a practice also. And again, you see here, we have taken the short axis measure from the inner edge to inner edge, go and take up to the commissures and manage this. And why do I say this? Every time you do, you'll find some different values, so take an average also. Actually, I may be wrong, but my personal experience is that mid-diastole doesn't work so much also, but the best is to take the shorter distance as you come back from the papillary muscle towards the mitral wall. So that is how you do it, and as I told you, you must practice, only then you will get it. Any specific question on this 2D mitral wall area?
anybody can open up their mic and ask a question if they have any.
Sir, why mid-diastole? Why not diastole?
Pardon me?
His question is, why not diastole? Why mid-diastole?
No, that is why it is because it is believed that it is the now when you hear a murmur of a mitral stenosis, you always hear that there is a mid-diastolic murmur, correct? You not say the that it is early diastolic murmur. So it is believed that possibly at a mid-diastole, the area is the best to measure at different studies that have shown maybe a smallest diameter also at a mid-diastole. That was the time when the murmur also starts and then you do measure at mid. So I said ki, what we normally don't know. If you see, we have not measured in mid-diastole, it is coming somewhere here. And then we found that was the correct method, this like this. So some things are written in the books also that you get the best area at the tip and the shortest or area during mid-diastole. So that is why it has been thought that mid-diastole can be done also.
We can say also, sir, at the same time, whenever the mitral valve is maximally open, that is the time we can say that. We can take that area.
No, maximally open.
Yeah, maximally open in a
because it is a sort of a funnel shaped structure.
Funnel shaped structure with the maximum open tip of the leaflets are seen, whether it's mid or late, where we can measure it.
Yeah.
And second important issue is today now with biplane method, when we take a paracentesis long axis view, we can cut at the tip of the mitral valve leaflet directly also. That's how we have started doing it now.
That is why 3D area is definitely sort of a much better as compared to 2D.
So any other questions before we break for today's sessions?
Why there is a significant mean gradient only? Why not peak gradient?
See, as we told you, now if I show you that slide, as we told you that the peak gradient is vary upon the blood flow also, and if the blood flow is more, then the peak gradient will be more. So as a result of which we now the mean gradient is also getting a sort of a less importance also as compared to the area, because these gradients vary with the amount of flow. Across, for example, patient with anemia, for a patient with an anemia, for example, you'll see that there will be a different value because they've increased blood flow. And now see if you hear, I have written peak gradient, aortic valve and pulmonary valve. That is in aortic valve and pulmonary valve, we give more importance also to the peak gradient. But the mean gradient is given a lesser peak gradient, lesser tracing the Doppler envelope also, because they are flow dependent and they are tachycardia dependent also. But still, if you see the guideline of the ACC, AHA guideline 2014, In which they have written the types also, you'll find that they are mainly concentrated on symptoms, area, and they have not brought mean gradient into that. If you read that will be my other lecture also. So if you just open that grade line, and you will see that they have given more importance to the anatomy and the symptoms and the valve area, and less to the gradient also, because they are so variable. You take a gradient now, tomorrow the patient develops anemia, his gradient will be varied. That is why I said that whenever you report a mitral stenosis, always mention about heart rate, gradient, and other factors. not just what you saw by the area also, because it can vary any time because of the flow. That is why we have given more importance to aortic stenosis and pulmonary stenosis and less to these to mitral stenosis also.
In mitral stenosis, further we comment on pulmonary artery pressure by TR jet velocity. Same in tricuspid stenosis. Is there any comparison with that?
When there is a stenosis, say there are two things will happen. Again, the RA pressure will increase as compared to the above, as compared to this pulmonary artery, this RV or so. Now, for example, let us give an example of mitral stenosis with aortic stenosis. In mitral stenosis, less flow goes from the LA to LV. So the less flow, blood flow goes from the LV to the aorta, and the gradients will be underestimated also. So similarly, when you see a TR jet velocity, a mitral stenosis, the tricuspid stenosis will produce a TR jet velocity gradient in an anti-grade direction towards RV, but not toward the RA also, so that it will be a much more effective way to see for the pulmonary artery pressure also. So that I'll tell you, show you just now here. So you see, these are some of the main causes also, and you see this, the TR jet here you see. So every concomitant stenotic lesion will have some effect on the hemodynamics also. Remember one thing, that is why there is always a very separate topic on it. I think you will also have a multivalvular lesion. So one wall definitely affects. The presence of mitral regurgitation will affect the severity of the mitral stenosis. So here you see, this is producing once you see this, the TR jet is coming down below, it's almost about 4 meters per second, and this is forward. So this will slightly vary, but here in these cases, the tricuspid stenosis doesn't affect in the sense, because we are more worried about the stenosis part also. The pulmonary artery hypertension, you can calculate by various other means also, if you have doubt also. There are so many other means to calculate it. But as remember, some lesions do affect on these cases also. Now here again, you have to take an average of 3. Say this is these are all stable because it was then during expiration. Only one time possibly the patient could not do a better also.
Any other questions from the audience? So there's one more question which has come from the Dr. Shamshad. He says, sir, please explain assessment of mitral stenosis by Doppler. I think you've already explained it. One slide, sir, he'll be able to understand us again.
Say, this was just the steps for the Doppler study of mitral wall, just few, only the Doppler study. Obtained the, first of all, you take an apical 4-chamber view. Put a color flow and see that you are parallel to the flow. Obtain the maximum velocity. How? By getting a CW Doppler and doing a sort of a good Doppler study. Then after you have calculated the maximum velocity, obtain a mean gradient in TVI by planimetering the method, then determine the mitral wall area by a pressure half time. and then determine the PA pressure. So these are from an apical point of view, you can get the mean maximum velocity, maximum gradient, mean velocity, mean gradient, mitral wall area by PST method, and the PA pressure. Because PA pressure has also got an importance in this picture. So that is one slide will tell you what is the various steps or so.
During reporting, we have to write the mitral wall area by planimetry or mitral area wall area by pressure half time.
Both you can write both. You can put, they may be slightly variable. You can write that the mitral wall area by 2D planimeter so and so, and by PST method is so and so. Now, they, if you have done a good study, they will take the mitral wall area by 2D also. But you can always matter both. In the Doppler studies, because there is, when you do a report, there is a report also in the Doppler studies. So you can write there also. Yes. And thank remember, you, a mitral wall area decreases by 0.1 to 0.3 centimeters square every year. So this is the one simple method. Knowing that that by apical views you can get all the Doppler studies done.
All right, anybody else? Please mute. Ravish, stop your mic completely. We are, sir, we'll stop it over here. People have started talking on the phones. Okay. Over here. We'll just stop it over here, sir.